Good morning, Hilltop. Thank you for joining us this morning as we worship God. We're excited to have you this morning. Would you join us in song and in praise as we lift up the name of our God? Amen. Oh, we love you, Father. We just thank you for your grace this morning. Lord, you are worthy of our praise. Oh, thank you for your grace, Jesus. Come on, church, who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power?
we thank you for your amazing grace. Lord, we also thank you that your love never fails. We're not done praising him, church. Go ahead and keep putting those hands together this morning. We're thankful that there is nothing that can separate us from his love. Lord, we proclaim this morning you are always faithful. Come on, let's sing it out. Here we go. Nothing can separate, even if I ran away, Lord, because your love never fails. That's right, it never fails, God. Lord, I know I still make mistakes. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love.
You stay the same through the ages.
walking according to your ways.
You made all things work together for my good.
For those that love you, God,
you made all things work together for my good.
So I count that promise, God.
You made all things work together for my good.
Lord, thank you for working all things together for our good. You alone are worthy, God. You alone are worthy, Jesus.
It was my cross you bore so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. We sing worthy, and worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. My shame is gone. I stand amazed in your love undeniable. Your grace goes on, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. And worthy is your name. You are worthy, Jesus. We exalt your name, Father. We sing this out, church.
Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. So be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the
morning, Hilltop. Thanks for tuning in this morning. I've got a few things I'd like to share with you. If you're watching on Facebook, would you share this stream right now? We want to share this message with as many people as possible. People need today's message. Hey, Hilltop families, are you looking for kids' Bible studies? Hilltop Kids Ministry videos are available every Wednesday and Sunday on our Hilltop Community Church YouTube channel and Facebook. Attention, graduates! We would like to honor graduates who call Hilltop Community Church home by putting together a video that we will stream in June during our service. If you have a high school or college graduate you would like to include, please email a graduation photo to hilltopmatt@comcast.net. Please include your graduate's name, school, degree, and phone number. Please send them to us by Sunday, May 31st. Impact students and families, Wednesday nights at 7 p.m., our youth are meeting on Zoom. If you have a student or know of someone who would like to join, please email Pastor Matt for the login info at hilltopmatt@comcast.net. Do you know someone who does not have access to this simulcast? Maybe they aren't connected to Facebook or YouTube. We'd love to send them a free DVD of today's service. Just call the church office at 510-223-2431. Also, if you or someone you know isn't on our email list, please visit our webpage to update your information. Thank you for continuing to support Hilltop financially. Our ministry continues because of your faithfulness. You can give online by going to hilltopcommunitychurch.com and clicking the Support Our Ministries graphic. Remember, if you need anything from us, especially if you are shut in and unable to leave your home, you can reach us at 510-223-2431 or by visiting our website at hilltopcommunitychurch.com. We'll see you next week.
Well, this is a time when we would normally be receiving the Lord's tithes and offerings. And again, I can't help but say thank you, thank you, thank you. As this closing down of the churches has become a protracted period of time, I want to thank you for your faithfulness in giving. As you continue to trust Jesus, we're trusting with you as well. Thank you for allowing us to continue to be bright light and strong salt in our world and our community through the gifts that you render from the Lord to the church and then from the church to our community and to the world. Again, if you have the opportunity, I would encourage you, you can go to hilltopcommunitychurch.com. You can go to the site there and there's a place, a button for giving. You can go there, click on that, and you can make your donations. Either one-time gift or you can make it an ongoing gift, a regular scheduled giving. And there's also another way for which you to do it. I've talked about these envelopes here. These are postage paid envelopes that we would normally put in our bulletins, although we can't get bulletins to you. But if you would call the church and would like to receive some of these envelopes, we can send them to you. And then it's postage paid. You won't have to even worry about getting a stamp, going out and getting a stamp. And you can make your gifts to us through that way. Again, I cannot say enough how proud I am to be a part of Hilltop Community Church. My wife and I are regular givers. We give of our tithes and extend ourselves even farther and gifts towards kingdom builders and missions. We're so grateful to be a part of a church that follows the example of Christ and being a giver. And so thank you again for that. And now we're going to be coming back to you real soon with a message. God bless you. Good morning, Hilltop. It's so glad to be with you this morning. There's an old parable that says all sunshine and no rain makes a desert. If you've never had any down times, dark times, gloomy times in your life, well, you'll become dried up. You'll have no depth to yourself, no maturity. It takes good times and bad times to make a mature person. Life is a mixture of pain and pleasure, of victory and of defeat, of success and of failure, of mountaintops and, yes, even valleys. Today, we're going to look at God's cure to the dark valleys of life. Now, even in our darkest valleys, our darkest days, God is there. David wrote in Psalms 23, verse 4, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Did you know in Israel there's a real valley of the shadow of death? It's a steep, deep, and narrow canyon. The sun only hits the bottom of it when it's directly overhead at high noon. The rest of the time, the bottom of the canyon is dark. Now, David probably led his sheep through the valley of the shadow of death as he was growing up. And as you read through your Bible, the term valley also refers to all kinds of rough times in life. Joshua talks about the valley of calamity. Psalms 84 talks about the valley of weeping. Hosea talks about the valley of trouble. Now, this verse that we're looking at in Hebrew actually means the valley of deep darkness. So how do I handle the dark valleys of life? Well, there are five facts about valleys that you need to remember. Whenever you're going through a tough time, you need to remember this. Number one, valleys are inevitable. They're going to happen. They're just going to happen, so you might as well count on them. Either you're just going to you're just coming out of a valley, or you're going to be going into one, or maybe you're probably headed towards one. Or valleys happen, in other words, throughout life, one right after another. After every mountain, there is a valley. Jesus was very realistic about this. And in fact, in John 16, he says, "In this world, you will have trouble." It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. It's going to happen. You're going to have difficulty. You're going to have disappointment. You're going to have discouragement in life. There will be times of suffering and sorrow and sickness. There will be times of frustration and failure and fatigue. They are going to happen. They are a normal part of life. So don't be surprised about it. The second fact is that valleys are unpredictable. You can't plan them, time them, schedule them. Valleys are always unexpected. They usually come at the worst time. I mean, when you don't have any time and when you're unprepared, I mean, have you ever found out that or discovered that you have a flat tire at the wrong time? It's never at a good time. They just happen. They happen usually when you least need them and it's most inconvenient. Imagine how great it would be if you could schedule your downtimes in life like we've been doing with the COVID. It's not scheduled. No one scheduled a plan for the COVID-19 virus. It just happened. However, it did happen. In the same way, you can't plan life like that. Valleys come suddenly. They're unpredictable. Have you ever noticed how easily a good day can become a bad day? I mean, one phone call, a letter, a routine doctor's checkup, even a freak accident. Valleys just happen. Jeremiah 4, verse 20 says, "Disaster follows disaster. In an instant, my tents are destroyed. My shelter falls in a moment." The third fact about valleys is that valleys are impartial. No one is immune to them. No one is insulated from pain and sorrow. And we've seen this in our day. The coronavirus is indiscriminate. Our missionaries tell us of the devastation literally around the world. No one gets to skate through life problem-free. Wherever you are in the world, everybody has problems. Good people, bad people, problems, trials, difficulties, disturbances, downtimes, depression. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. You know what it means? It means you're a person. It doesn't mean you're an evil human being. It means you're a human being. The Bible is very clear that good things happen to bad people. And sometimes bad things happen to good people. Valleys are impartial. They don't care how good or bad you are. Matthew 5:43, Jesus said, "It rains on the just and the unjust too." And when you go through a difficult time, you know, a valley in life, the first reaction is always, "Why me? Why me?" Yet really we should be asking, "Why not me?" Do you think that you should be exempt from all the problems that everybody else has to go through? Do you think you should be the only one in the universe that never has a tragedy, a loss, loses a loved one? Instead of saying, "Why me?" just realize it's going to happen because you're a human being. Remember, as I've said it before, this is not heaven. Things are not perfect here, and there are problems and difficulties. They are going to happen in life. It's going to happen to good people, Christians. Disasters and tragedies happen to all of us. The fourth fact is that valleys are temporary. They have an end to them. They don't last. They're not a permanent location. David says, even though I walk through the valley. You see, the valley is not something you stay in your entire life. It's something you go through. It's a circumstance, a situation that has a season to it. And when you're in a valley, you often think it's a dead end, but it's not. It's like a tunnel. There's a beginning and an end. You go through the tunnel and eventually you're out of it and you're back in the light again. They don't come into your life to say to stay with you all forever. They come to pass. In 1 Peter 1:6, the Living Bible says, there is a wonderful joy ahead, even though the going is rough for a while down here. He admits that sometimes you're going to go through tough times. It's going to be rough. Life is tough. You're going to have to endure it, but it's only for a while. There's a wonderful joy ahead. And you know what he's talking about? He's talking about heaven. There are no problems in heaven, no valleys, no dark days. And while you may be harassed down here, in heaven, you'll have no problems whatsoever. If you know the Lord Jesus Christ, that's where you're going to go, heaven. And he's saying, don't get discouraged. Even if you live 80 or 90 years and have a problem your entire life, that is so insignificant compared to the thousands and millions and billions of years in eternity, problem-free. He says, even if it's your whole life, it's just temporary compared to the light of eternity. In 2 Corinthians 4:17 in the New English Bible, it says, our troubles are short-lived and there is an eternal glory which outweighs them all. They won't last. They will be short. But he says, there is an eternal glory. This is important. Pain can be productive. There will be benefits from your problems if you respond in the right way. While we have temporary hassles, there is a long-term eternal benefit when you go through the valley and respond to it correctly. The fifth fact about valleys is that valleys are purposeful. God has a reason for taking you through the valleys. Whether it's doubt, depression, despair, discouragement, defeat, hey, he's got a reason behind it. 1 Peter 1:6-7 says, at the present, you may be temporarily harassed by all kinds of trials. He says temporary. They aren't going to last. You're temporarily harassed with problems here. And there will be all kinds of trials. Yes, there will be. There are financial valleys, there are relational valleys, emotional valleys, all different kinds of trials. But then 1 Peter continues by saying this, this is no accident. It happens to prove your faith. The valleys are not just a freak of nature. You see, God wants to build your faith in the valleys of life. We love to enjoy mountaintops, the beautiful views, but you don't build your faith on top of mountains. You build faith in the valleys of life. When everything's going fine and great, you don't really need God, but when you come face to face with the dark valley, you get on your knees because faith is strengthened in the valleys. When you don't feel like serving and trusting God, praising God, that's where your faith is tested, not in the good times of life, but in the valleys. So you need to understand that every problem has a purpose. Even the little tiny ones, the inconsequential ones, the things that seem like mere irritations, they have a purpose. You see, God can teach you character there. He wants to change you and mature you. Secondly, faith is built in the valleys of life. God wants to build your character. He's far more interested in your character than he is in your comfort or your convenience. God's goal in life is not just to make life comfortable for you. He wants to build character. He's more interested in your holiness than he is in your happiness. Holiness lasts. Happiness, it doesn't. Happiness comes from holiness anyway. He wants to make you like Jesus. He wants you to develop the character of Christ. Now, if God is going to make you like Jesus, He's going to take you through all the circumstances of life that he took Jesus through. Was Jesus exempt from suffering? No, absolutely not. What makes you think that you're going to be exempt from suffering? Did Jesus go through tough times of loneliness? Yes. Will you? Yes. Was Jesus ever tempted to be discouraged? Yes. Will you? Yes. Was Jesus ever misunderstood, maligned, criticized, unjustly? Yes. Will you? Absolutely. What makes you think that you're any different? You're going to go through the valleys. God wants to build character in your life, and it's not by accident. Does God cause accidents and tragedies? Absolutely not. God doesn't cause accidents and tragedies. God is a good God, and he cannot cause evil. He cannot do evil. Can God use accidents and tragedies for good? Absolutely. He can use even the evil done to us by others and turn it around and bring good out of it to build the character in us. He definitely uses the tragedies and valleys of our life. So what do you do when you go through dark valleys? Well, David says, I will fear no evil, for you're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The first thing you do is you refuse to be discouraged. I will fear no evil. Remember the no fear t-shirts a long time ago when I was a youth pastor? I always thought Christians should be the ones wearing all those no fear t-shirts. I will fear no evil. I fear nothing. That's what David says as a Christian who puts his faith in God. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, notice it says I walk, not I run through it or I panic and run the other way. To walk means calmly, to deliberately make steps through the valley. David says, I'm not going to be afraid. I will calmly walk through the valley. Refuse to be discouraged. You can't go around the valley. Can't go under the valley. Can't go over the valley. You can only go through the valley. And here he says, I will not fear evil. You know, will, when he says, I will not, implies a choice. It implies an act of volition, decision. I'll not be afraid. If you're discouraged today, it's because you're choosing to be discouraged. I don't have to know your problems. You're choosing to be discouraged. Discouragement, if you're discouraged, discouragement is a choice. It's always a choice. You don't have to choose to be discouraged, but you're choosing to think discouraging thoughts. You're choosing to look at the negatives. You're choosing to not look at Christ and all the positive things. You're looking at the negatives. That's a choice. You can choose to change too. That's what God wants you to do. Choose. It's a deliberate act. So how do I choose to not be discouraged? Well, simply by focusing on God's power rather than on your problem. That's how you do it. You can take two people and put them in the identical situations, a chaos, a tragedy, a crisis, and one of them will be blown away by it, all undone, and the other is actually strengthened by it. One of them falls apart, and one of them is strengthened through it. The difference is what you're focusing on. You need to focus not on your circumstances, but on Christ. Not on the situation, but on the Savior. Not on your problems, but on God's power. Colossians 1:11, the New Century Version says, God will strengthen you with his own great power, so that you will not give up when troubles come, but you will be patient. Human energy runs out. After a trial of a certain length of time, you don't have any energy left. No stamina. You're spent. Human endurance has an end to it. It runs out. It becomes depleted. In the valleys of life, you need a power source bigger than yourself. If you think you're going to make it through all the valleys of life on your own power, forget it. You're not going to. You don't have enough power to handle all the things that are going to hit you in this life. You need a power source beyond yourself to step into, to key into, to grab onto. Number two, remember that God is with me. David says, for you are with me. You're with me every moment. God not only promises us his power in the valley, he promises his presence. You'll never go through a valley in life by yourself. You'll never go through a dark day alone. God said, I will be with you. Isaiah 43, verse 2, Living Bible says, when you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. I love that. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fires of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. You're not going to drown. You're not going to burn up. You're not going to die. God says, I'm with you. He will be with you every step in the valley. God says, there is nothing to fear when Jesus is near. God does not set up in heaven and look down on you and say, boy, I sure hope he makes it. I sure hope he make it. He's there with you in the valley, walking with you, hand in hand. God says, I will lead you through this. At verse 4 of Psalm 23, there's a strategic change in the language. In the first part of the psalm, all the pronouns are in the third person. He's talking about God. He leads me beside still waters. He guides me into green pastures. He restores my soul. David is talking about God. But when he gets to the valley, it changes to a second person pronoun. He starts talking not about God, but to God. You are with me. Your rod, your staff comfort me. It's the valleys of life that bring us face to face with God. All of a sudden, the ultimate becomes the intimate. When I'm going through the valley, I don't want to talk about God. I want to talk to God. Religion becomes a relationship there. Any mature believer will tell you that the times that they've been closest to God were in those times they were face-to-face encounters that happened only in the valley. When you're in the valley, you're spent, depleted, perplexed, you're in despair, and you're talking directly to God. He becomes real. And God says, I am with you. You're not in this by yourself. You see, we enjoy mountaintops, but we come face to face with God in the valleys of life. You'll never be closer than when you're in the valley. The third thing is, I rely on God's protection and guidance. David reminds himself that God's rod and staff comforts him. The rod and staff are the two of the basic tools that a shepherd used to protect and guide the sheep. A rod has basically about two feet long, and at the end of it was a heavy knot. And shepherds were very skilled at hurling that rod like a missile at anything that would attack the sheep. And God is saying, when you go through the valley, I'm defending you. I'm protecting you. The rod of God will protect you. Well, today shepherds don't use rods, they use guns. And it's really interesting that in the Old West, a gun is also called a rod. God says, I'm going to defend you. I'm going to protect you. And when you're going through the valley, the dark valley of life, God is not setting up in heaven unconcerned and apathetic. The good shepherd fights for you. While you're fighting for your life in that depression, God is fighting right alongside of you. He's fighting off spiritual forces. He's your defender and your protector. And that's what the rod represents. Your staff comforts me. A staff was a long stick with a crook at the end of it. And the shepherd used the staff to guide and to comfort. He'll use the staff to draw the sheep close to him. He'll use the staff to lift them up when they're down. He brings them in close with the staff. He also uses a staff to guide them. And when you go through the valley, you're not going through it alone. God's going with you, and he's using his rod and staff to protect and guide. And when you go through a valley of life, the scary parts are the shadows. I mean, in the darkness, you just see the shadows on the wall of the valley as you're going through that canyon, and you're thinking, how am I going to make it? How am I going to make it? And David says, when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, notice, he didn't walk through the valley of death, but the valley of the shadow of death. One day, someday, a shadow is going to fall over your life. You can count on it. You'll experience one of those shadow moments. Maybe you're feeling it right now. When those times come, you need to remember three important things about shadows. You need to remember these. The first one is that shadows are always bigger than reality. Fear is always greater than the actual problem. It's the fear that's enormous. And number two, you got to realize this, that shadows cannot hurt you. Have you ever been run over by a shadow? You see, there's a big difference between the shadow of a truck and the truck itself. Shadows are images without substance. They cannot hurt you. They can scare you, but they cannot hurt you. They're just shadows. The third thing you need to remember about shadows is that there is no shadow without a light somewhere. When you're going through a dark valley, you think the sun has stopped shining. God is dead. I'm all alone. You can't see it all, and you think you're in total darkness. But anytime there is a shadow, it means there is a light somewhere. And when you start to get afraid of the shadow in the dark valleys of life, turn your back on the shadow and look directly at the light. And guess what? The shadow falls behind you. When you're afraid, don't look at the shadow. Turn in the exact opposite direction and look at the light. And the shadow falls behind you. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And when you look at him, you cannot be afraid of all the other shadows around you. They fall behind you. If you look at the world, hey, you'll be distressed. If you look within yourself, hey, you're going to get depressed. But if you look at Jesus, you'll be at rest. It's really your choice. It all depends on what you're looking at. It's like the old song. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. So don't look at the shadows. When you're walking through the valley, look at the light. Psalms 34:19 says, the good man does not escape all troubles. He has them too. But the Lord helps them in each and every one. It's obvious that Christians go through valleys just like everybody else does. Christians have disappointments. Christians get sick. Christians experience tragedies. Christians lose loved ones. Christians have financial problems. God's people have family problems. Yes, they do. Believers go through valleys just like everybody else does. But there is a difference, and it's a big difference. The difference is that while believers and non-believers go through the same valleys of life, the difference for the Christian is not the absence of the shadow, but the presence of the shepherd. And I want to leave you with these four words before we pray. God is with you. Would you bow your heads with me as we go, Lord, in prayer here today? Now, Father, again, I'm asking that you touch my friends here. That, Lord, I know some have been racked with fear as the news has come on and talked about all kinds of things from the COVID-19 and to even murder hornets coming from Asia and that they'll kill all the honeybees, and if the honeybees die, we'll not have any crops, that there'll be meat shortages and all these things, Lord. They're shadows. They're shadows that come upon the walls of our lives. And Lord, I pray that you'd help my friends to remember, turn their backs on the shadow and look directly into your face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of your glory and your grace. Now again, I'm speaking to those of you right now who may be going through tough times. I just want to encourage you. Don't get caught up in the anxiety of things. Depression and discouragement, they are choices. Choose rather to believe in the promises of God. As I've said numerous times, there were 7,000 promises that God makes to us in his word. Read your word daily and ask Christ to make it alive in you. And today, if you haven't made Jesus the shepherd of your life, again, as I say all the time, why not today? Why not now? Why wait? Why not make him the leader and the forgiver of your life? Ask him to forgive you of your sins that you know that you've committed and other people know about you as well. Ask him to forgive you. And then make him the leader of your life. Choose to trust him. As I've said numerous times, it really does matter who you trust. And you know whether or not you trust in something by whether or not you act upon it. And so I'm asking you to act upon this truth that I've given you today. To act upon the fact that he's the good shepherd. That he provides the cure to the anxieties of our life. Even in these days and times in which we find ourselves. So would you ask him today? Would you simply say, Jesus, please forgive me. Jesus, please be my leader and my guide. And help me to find life in all of its fullness. I know he'll do that. Because he's done that for me and countless others. So again, I want to encourage you today. This being the fifth part of the cure, let's take it to heart. And let's be bright light and strong salt. Let's encourage other people with the truths that you've just heard from me. Again, I'm no expert on all these things, but I do take what the scripture says in 2 Timothy 2:2, where it says, commit to faithful men and women the things that you've seen and heard and known of me. Paul saying that to Timothy, and I'm saying that to you. What I'm passing on to you was committed to me by others, men and women in times past and even contemporaries, but we're passing on the same truth. Jesus, God, is with you. God bless you. We look forward to seeing you next week. God bless you.